Ladies and gentlemen, this is a regularly scheduled meeting in Sunderland Board of Selectmen, if we can call it to order at 6:31. We're just talking about soft lighting, that for some reason when the officers of law enforcement show up, all these bright lights are off, which I happen to actually like. Thank you, Director Publisher. We're going to start off tonight with a couple of appointments. We have a meeting with Officer in Charge Lyons, a couple of part-time appointments and a full-time appointment, a recommendation. We have some minutes to go through. You know, we're in the full throes of annual town meeting, so we have a warrant that's closing today as of 5, and we're headed toward that final Friday in April. And for people who don't go to town meeting but watch this and live in town, come to town meeting. It's your one chance to actually hold up your hand and vote, and it's fundamentally democratic. So please come to town meeting. That's 7 o'clock at the elementary school on the last Friday of April every single year. So you get to vote on your budget, you get to vote on bylaws, you get to vote on all kinds of things and see your neighbors. We're going to have a couple of updates, and then we're going to talk about a little additional levy cap that's an annual function for funding capital stabilization in the town. And that's something that the board has to do once a year. So first up tonight, if we could, comments from the board before we get going. First up tonight, we have Officer in Charge Lyons, and we have a couple of part-time appointments. There have been recent departures from the department on the part-time level, and of course we still have a full vacancy with respect to a full-time officer. So, Sergeant, what do you think?
Well, I just want to thank the gentleman here for allowing me to be present. With me, I have two candidates that I have recommended for appointment to a part-time status. Currently, we have 5 part-time officers with the department, and recently we've gone through some significant personnel changes. Chief Gilbert retired last month, and another one of our full-time officers retired last week. So our staffing levels are at 5 right now. I would be more comfortable with having about 8 part-time officers on our staff. A round of interviews were conducted over the last couple of weeks. We interviewed 11 applicants, and the two gentlemen we have here this evening, Bryn Raptor and Jose Cabrera, did very excellent on their interviews. Both have successfully completed the part-time academy. Mr. Raptor works part-time up at the Berninson Police Department and at the Irving Police Department. Mr. Cabrera works over at the University of Massachusetts with the Police Cadet Program. Both know the importance of community policing, being out in the community, letting the presence be known, talking to people. Mr. Cabrera actually volunteers time being a referee for basketball games, umpiring baseball games, working with the Leisure Services and Supplemental Education Program, which I had never heard of until Mr. Cabrera applied to our department. So he is very actively involved with the community in Amherst. So I've forwarded my recommendation to have these two gentlemen appointed for the police department.
Nice. Discussion of the members of the board?
You're gonna handle the part-timers first?
Yes, part-timers
Chief?
First.
Officer?
Yeah, we'll do the part-timers first.
In charge?
Three yes, hats. Part-timers first. Unless you want to do one.
And I'll call you Lieutenant Hat Rack.
You can call me whatever you like.
So part-time officers first would be the agenda approach. Again, you got Bryn Raptor and Jose Cabrera. And I guess if I could maybe start off, Mr. Cabrera, the hard and fast reality is there a link between policing skills and basketball refereeing?
Yeah.
There must be.
Yeah, I absolutely think there are. You know, it's judgment calls every day, and I think more on a basketball level, though, I get fought against for the wrong call.
It's a rougher crowd, isn't it?
It's a little bit of a rougher crowd.
So explain the difference between a blocking foul and a charge.
When in doubt, send it out.
See?
There you go.
See?
I think you've said something along that.
Well, I say when I make the call, it depends on what sideline I'm standing next to.
Got it.
If I'm next to the guy on defense, it's definitely a charge. If I'm next to the guy on offense, it's a block and all the every single time.
So that's a lesson from a politician right there.
Yes.
As opposed to reffing, right? Okay. So if I could circle back and ask Brendan about scheduling pressures, not details, but in this case here, what's the lead up post-appointment to actually covering shifts?
Well, it really depends on the candidate.
Yeah.
You know, how quickly they absorb the information we provide to them, how quickly they can become familiar with the layout of the town, the roads, the businesses, apartments, and even, you know, just the street locations. But both candidates here, they use the same police reporting system that we use, so they're already well-versed with that, so that really won't take much time at all. So I anticipate by June they'll be well on their way to be on the road by themselves.
Perfect. Thank you. I appreciate that. David, any comments?
And that's assuming why you're looking for eight people, too, to give you a little flexibility with the schedule and everything there, right?
Well, even though hopefully two will be appointed tonight, when we get to Mr. Peters, we'll actually really only be gaining one.
Right, because you're kind of like flipping them over to the other side.
Yeah. So, yeah. And depending on how town meeting goes, there's a possibility there may be more money put into the part-time wages, which will mean more shifts could be provided to the part-time officers. And having five officers to take as many as 30 shifts possibly a month, it's very difficult to rely on officers for 12 months to take several shifts a month.
Okay. Tom, did you jump out off the resume application and recommendation?
No, I was just going to say, Brendan, I think you actually have brought forward very strong candidates. I like Brendan's knowledge in sign language.
Yes.
And again, there's little things sometimes when you're out on patrol, and you get in your situations, it's how you diffuse certain things, and something as simple as that may be able to the knowledge of a second language and or experience experience in the community is a strong thing. And the last time we had the officers in, I made the comment that I believe our police department, you guys go out and do a very difficult job every single day, and no one knows that better than the three of us. But I also think we've been very fortunate in our town to have very good officers that aren't afraid to have their windows rolled down on their cruiser to listen to what's going on outside and around them. And being familiar with our community is a good thing. Stopping to talk to people out raking the lawn or just to get to know you guys is an important thing. So I was very pleased to look at the breadth of experience that you brought forward, Brendan. It's a nice job.
Thank you.
Okay, and if there's any other discussion, if not, is there a motion to recommend on the part-time officers?
Motion.
Second.
It's always the same thing. It's like rock, paper, scissors. Yeah. So we have a motion made and seconded, and that's...
For discussion.
For discussion.
I do know one of Mr. Cabrera's references. We'll have her keep her eye on that gentleman.
He's a strong reference, but... All right, we long shadow. It's all right. So that said,
he's a good gentleman. He's a very good cop, also.
Yeah, nice guy.
Yes, very nice. Tough but fair.
Yes.
Tough but fair.
Good way to put it. Okay, so the part-time officers in front of us, Bryn Raptor and Jose Cabrera, both to be accepted as part-time appointments. Now the appointment schedule comes up, and don't get alarmed by it. We will begin in about May looking at the roster for the upcoming appointment schedule. So you'll be voted on potentially twice in the next 4 months. So don't take it personally. It's just the calendar. Okay. There's no other discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. 3-0. And I want to express my thanks for both of you for both applying and showing the interest to work in the Sunderland community. Okay, so next up, Sergeant Lyons, we're going to lose a part-time officer, potentially, and gain a full-time officer, potentially. Someone who's been in the community a little while now.
Thank you, Brendan. Mr. Peters has been with the department for just over 2 years. In that time, he's shown he's a very knowledgeable officer. not only that, but he's been a very dependable officer. He's our part-time officer who works the most shifts each and every month. He works weekends, he works holidays, overnights. Whatever we need him for, he's 99% available to work. In addition to that, he works full-time. He's a security officer at Yankee Candle. He works the 4 to 12 shift there, and oftentimes he'll come in for an overnight shift with us. So he'll get out of work at midnight at Yankee Candle, come in and work the overnight for the police department here. Whenever he's asked to do something, he does so without hesitation, or complaining, just a very dependable officer. Again, we lost the chief in February. We lost another full-time officer earlier this month, so we're two full-time officers down. Kind of puts us in a tight spot, but with the five part-time officers we have currently, we're managing cover shifts currently. I don't know if we can comfortably cover those shifts for another 2 or 3 months, so that's why I've recommended Mr. Peters be appointed to full-time status.
Okay. So, Mr. Peters, you've been here since 14. Brendan, I see that we've got a temporary waiver here. And the temporary waiver is in and around what area that the town waives?
Well, that would allow Ben to work 40 hours a week for up to 260 days, enough, which would be more than enough time to allow him to get up to the next academy, which is anticipated to start in
September.
September.
I think fall, yeah.
So, you know, this would allow him to work full-time hours without having the full-time academy.
Got it. So this, the waiver, the discussion around the waiver isn't centered around existing training, existing credentials. It's allowing for time in a 40-hour environment.
Yes. Yeah, without the full-time academy.
Got it. I think that's an important distinction to have out there. It's not for a lack of skills or training. It's a function of availability to work inside of a full-time format.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
And there are specific criteria that he needs prior to that waiver even being signed, and he has met each and every one of those criteria.
I raise that point. It was a bit of a lead-in, only in that it's important that the public knows not filling spaces for part-time to full-time without having all the qualifications and move to full-time. Okay. Thank you. Questions of the board? Tom, what do you think? There's someone who's been here for a couple of years now, several years?
Nope, that's... Again, Mr. Peters has a nice resume. He's a hard-working guy. He looks like he's... You know, there's a lot of different ways people can start their career. He's doing it the right way, so that's
Thank
a good
you, sir.
Good point.
Thank you very much.
Good point. David, anything?
No, I think I'm good.
Okay, at this time, I'll entertain a motion to appoint, getting right down there, Ben Peters, as a full-time officer for the town of Sunderland. Again, same deal. It'll come up again in May. So
okay.
Don't panic.
No problem.
Okay.
Motion.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
2-0, please. Brendan, to echo Tom's point, thanks for the fine work that you've been doing in both the interim status as well as bringing these appointments forward.
That's my pleasure. Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Nice to meet you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.
This is the great crossover.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Thanks so much. Talk to Sherry, okay?
Congratulations.
Thank
you. Congratulations,
everybody.
Have a good night. Can you make sure these go away?
Yep.
Sure.
A lot of personal information in those.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll give you mine too.
Okay.
Destruct pod.
That said, next up for us is going to be minutes of the 21st.
Motion.
Second on those.
We have a motion made and seconded for the minutes of March 21st. We had Berkshire to Boston bike event and some complete streets updates. All those in favor?
Aye.
2-0, please. Okay. So, under board updates, there's a capital planning committee set up being posted for Tuesday of the upcoming week, and this will be the first meeting of the revitalized Capital Planning Committee, an extension of the bylaw passed last year by town meeting, as well as the end of what used to be the Permanent Building Committee, and now kind of a larger amorphous, a larger amorphous look at total capital budget. There are a couple of vacancies in there, and if anybody's interested, please contact the office at 665-1441. Again, capital planning is going to be through the course of the year, 4 to 6 meetings total, and then looking at the assets and then the submissions for capital expenditures for the upcoming year. Okay? That's it. That's it with respect to me. Tom, anything?
Last week, had a meeting at the Deerfield Finance Committee to discuss the South County EMS budget. But it was a good, good discussion. We had, they had some interesting questions. Some we didn't have the answers to, but we recorded the questions, and they had the, unfortunately, Zach was not able to make it, but I got him to, he responded to the questions, and we forwarded those questions to the chair, or the answers to the questions to the chair of the Deerfield Finance Committee, so they should have that. The have a meeting in Whately at the new Whately Town Office Building, which is like 6 Sandy Lane, to discuss South County. There's a presentation by South County EMF. So if anyone's interested and want to come, we're all everybody's cordially invited, and that'll be starting on the 30th at so Wednesday night at 6:30 p.m. So if anybody wants to come over, come on over and have a good time. If you have any questions about South County EMS, or you just want to learn a little bit more about what's going on.
David, anything else?
Got an upcoming personnel committee meeting, which reminds me, we have an opening. We have at least one on there, so if anybody's interested in the personnel committee, we probably do about 4 meetings a year, too, I think, on that. So if anybody's interested in dealing with fun personnel committee things, like reviewing job descriptions and things like that, come on down and give us a call.
Well, David, you know, that's one of those areas, one of those committees that works on not just policy, but also has a formulaic approach toward compensation.
Yes.
There's peer reviews. There's, you know, we think about personnel or capital, or and they're kind of offshoots of what we all do, but boy, do they have an impact.
They do.
Lasting impact.
Right.
Perfect. Okay, Sherry, town administrator updates?
I don't have much. I'll be working on putting the capital budget request together for you in the committee. And the capital is part of the community compact that we filed as well. So we'll be working with Joe Markanian from FERCOG on capital planning, and I believe that's scheduled for the end of April, early May kickoff, and that'll probably be for next fiscal year.
Easy, right? It's just town meeting season. It's just the annual town meeting warrant. Yeah, there's not much going on. Well played. Well played indeed. Okay. I'm going to take a look at the actual warrant we have in front of us as of today. We opened the warrant last week. As of today, 5 p.m., the warrant closes. And the annual town meeting, as has been the last two, we will not be having a special town meeting prior to the annual. We'll start right off with the annual, and that'll include current year's business. So, that said, tonight, I guess the goal would be we don't have to deal with motions quite yet, but we also don't even have to have any motions to include quite yet. It might make sense for us to take a look at motions to include on things like the consent articles. Pretty straightforward.
Right.
But there is a good solid review in front of us for tonight, and there's one area about land swaps that may be still a work in progress. So as you look down the articles, reports to the selectmen, the articles here are currently not numbered, and that's okay. I say that only because there's a little configuring that goes on oftentimes with the moderator. We want the tempo or the meeting to kind of feel about that. if it's the board's prerogative, and the easy ones we can go through tonight that are motions to include, I'd be happy to do that. Case in point, the first one. Are we going to expect to hear, reports from boards and committees? Pretty standard stuff.
Yep.
Right? Go ahead, Tom.
Well, we're asking for $22,829.50 to cover the tuition. That's tuition and transportation?
And transportation for this year.
So we're on page two.
I thought it was going to be more than that.
We paid some from reserve.
All right.
For busing. They were looking for money.
So Tom, do you want to go to that one and have that start as a move to include? Or do you want to do a short review first and then save motions to include for a future meeting?
Well, I was just going to go down. I wasn't going to read every one. I was just going to look at. I was just going to see the ones that I, if I had any questions about.
Yep.
And you say you've got questions about the
land swap. There's a couple of alternates in there. And again, this may be a dynamic piece, and we can circle back. We'll go through it a little more programmatically. And the front page is pretty straightforward. A couple of, you've got salaries, you've got reports, you've got salaries. Municipal budget, and again, we're going to include at some point, capital stabilization, include at some point, and then we're on to page two. Capital budget from the funding sources. Abatement program for veterans. I'm going to put a little X right on this one so we can get some clarification on it. That is the creating of a revenue fund for PEG access.
I can pull the DOR has an IGR that gives you a couple of different alternatives of setting up that fund.
Okay. Then to your point, Tom, we've got Smith's Voc student attending plus transportation, $22,829.50. There's a clarification article here from the accountant. It's going to be submitted by us, but the accountant, if you look at it, it's one up from the bottom of page two, and that was an appropriate appropriation in total, the total dollar values, but the dissection of the contribution to the total was missing one element. The accountant brought that forward, and this is actually just a matter of cleaning it up from last year. That appropriation is just fine.
How did the article read?
It didn't include the sum of the $18,814 from sewer reserve.
Sewer reserve, yeah.
I think really? Only, yeah. There was a piece in there that we didn't quite.
I'm going to have to get my old thing.
I know. Same thing. I looked at the old warrant as well and talked about it with Brian.
Was it on the warrant?
It was on the warrant, yeah.
But so it was on the warrant?
We have to double check the motion versus the warrant.
I'm going to read the emails about this when
yeah.
they send it over.
Again, our total appropriation was correct.
Boy, we're getting pretty picky.
We're getting a little bit picky, and then you have things like this, and Tom, along that same theme, the Department of Revenue and the PEG Access Fund. Uh-huh. And you're going to see in front of us coming as well.
Yeah, we've had PEG Access for...
We're doing it anyway. This just formalizes it.
Uh-huh.
Right. I mean, we've had it for 20 years. Why do you
have to adopt it at town meeting?
You know, I'm just going to say, I'm not going to make it a lengthy thing.
Yeah.
The state of Massachusetts is screwed up.
Creates a special revenue fund, which...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think we're, you know, I'm sorry, but we're screwed up.
Well, it's actually in the same category, and I appreciate you bringing it up that way, because it is a bit screwed up. We have a PEG access provider right now, and we have neighboring communities going out because of guidance,
mm-hmm.
and now soliciting an RFP for PEG access. Like, okay. But I'm pretty sure we adapted that and created a contract. So here we are, half a dozen to 10 years now, with that relationship, and we have to do an RFP, it seems counterintuitive.
Yep.
So, it just seems counterintuitive. Seems almost onerous. A parcels A and B, this is the infamous boat dock triangle piece, right out here at the end of School Street. There's an A and a B. This is a work in progress. The alternate to B is also a work in progress.
Have you actually gotten letters back from everyone?
Everyone, yep. All of the owners known.
What are they saying?
They have all signed, but they all, yes, they all want to be compensated.
I thought like the first two just wanted it named after.
There were a couple of feedbacks about naming.
Yeah.
So what goes on here is we have a parcel of land that's right out here on School Street, infamously known as the Triangle, and it's consumed a fair amount of work. I mean that with every pun intended. And it is hopefully clarifying ownership of that in the town, setting aside a percentage, $22,000 of assessment value, for any potential owners or heirs that are part of this redirected little triangle right here in School Street, headed out toward the river. That's a process that is continuing to unfold, and we're looking to acquire that piece of property. To do that, there's a fund for 3 years?
Yeah, we have to hold 20% of that appraised value for 3 years, right, for owners unknown, in case they come forward. Yeah.
So the appraised value is $22,000 and change, just under $23,000. And again, we're going to be looking to set that money aside, and in that money being set aside, if there are owners or heirs that come forward, be able to buy out their percentage of that assessment. So you're going to see that here coming up to town meeting. That's an integral part of riverbank area boat dock revitalization, and I give a lot of credit to the folks on the Community Pathways group and CPA for working hard on that.
So we're looking for the $22,000 to come from.
I believe that's community
conservation funds, right?
What's that?
Yeah. I think it's community preservation. If you look CPA, on the next page, you'll see an article to see if the town will vote to appropriate $36,000
from CPA. Okay.
Tom, I think conservation covered legal title search, mm-hmm, all of that.
Surveying and that.
Oh, they also covered. There's actually, I mean, we're spending $22,000, but mm-hmm, we're getting $18,000 from
right,
another group. I mean, there's a lot of money, plus the boat ramp is going to be put in for Fish and Wildlife is putting in the boat ramp, and they're putting in parking, handicap parking. So, I mean, it's in when you're trying to do things, using money to leverage money to get more. So we're spending 22, but we're getting a lot more out of it.
It's a really good point, actually. There are a lot of players that aren't associated necessarily with town or town meeting trying to make that happen.
Right.
Good point. Then we've got the CPA articles. You get there a little bit extension of the discussion we were just having, $36,000, article 4, $52,000 for renovations and preservation of a three-year plan over at the Riverside Cemetery. And then the annually, we have to go through the appropriation for the upcoming year and the appropriation for the percentages for CPA. Each of the categories, historic preservation, community housing, open space, and then there's an undesignated fund element. There was a question, Sherry, about the value of CPA going forward with the match and going a little more conservatively this year. As opposed to, we've done very well with 100% match, but we're appropriating for a more conservative percentage.
It's my thing to do.
Well, if it comes in,
experience.
Yeah, right. If it comes in, it's fine. If it doesn't come in, you plan for this.
Yep.
Got it. Good point. Then we have a ton of Sunderland Tricentennial coming along. And we're going to put a value on that. Then there's a question about the building fund for the library, and the back and forth with the trustees and the accountant, there's some money set aside for the construction and long-term capital needs of the library, and the moving of those funds to being able to accept gifts and how to use those gifts appropriated by the trustees. And this, again, is a clarification of language. There's no new money associated with it. It's a matter of how that language is was spelled out in the original article, and how we have both the accountant, the trustees, and the DOR suggesting the language should read. And then we head off to the consent articles. So is it prerogative of the board to move to include a handful of these and keep this a living document, or it's a small enough warrant we can do this in a full-on meeting? What do you think?
No objections to do it next time now, if you want.
We can actually move to include the consent articles. It's pretty easy.
That's, and then the whole couple on the front, maybe.
Yeah. So page one. We're going to accept anyway, regardless. One, we don't have to include that. It's already there as part of it. We're not going to include budgets. We're not going to include elected officials until we get to the budget. We're not going to do that until we vote the budget. So page one outside of the very first one. Page two, capital budget's top. So that's off until we appropriate, get after the, well, there's no dollar values. Yeah, some are sums of money, sorry. Work-off abatement program. I'm looking at the second article on page two.
Could do that one.
Right. See if the town vote to accept chapter and verse, chapter 59, section 5N. We created a work-off abatement program for veterans. Is there any reason we would not want to include that on the warrant article?
Yeah.
On the warrant? Tom, what do you think?
No.
So is there a motion to, again, we're only talking about including now, not
right.
Recommending.
Motion.
Yeah, second.
Okay, so
I'm just having a hard time because there's no numbers relating to them.
Which one to refer to?
I mean, right.
We can call it page two, article.
You could put something, two. Even call them ABC.
Yeah, right. That's a good point. We could certainly do that, right?
Let's do that.
A, B, C, D, E, F, G. We'll call it article G. Right, and that has to do with creation of a work-off abatement program for veterans. Now we have a senior work-off.
Motion article G.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Motion made and seconded to include, we'll call it today, article G. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0.
Motion to include article H.
E or H?
H. The PEG access one?
G, H. Got it.
Yeah.
H.
Second.
PEG access. Creating a fund. Yep. Motion's made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0.
Motion for aye.
I was going to say, yep. Second.
I know it's on budget, but you have to pay this.
You got to pay this. It's right. Not a district placement.
Yeah. Right.
Motion's made and seconded to include. All those in favor?
Aye.
Well played.
Aye.
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 Aye. Right, right. Okay. So there's aye. Okay. Next page. Again, we have a couple pieces here that we have a little homework still to do on the language. Then there's the parcels. Okay. L, M, N. And we can get some more information. Then there's CPA recommendations. We'll begin with MNO, right? The bottom of page three, article O. Now these have CPC recommendations already, so the CPA articles.
This is just being presented, so I would say motion is presented by the CPC.
Right.
Yeah, and all we're doing
you
is to
do
include
all of them.
Yeah, right. Motion.
Yeah, right. Second.
Okay, motion is made and seconded to include the CPC article. We'll call it O for right now. Aye, 3-0.
Yes.
Okay. P.
Motion to include P.
That's the reserve funds for Riverfront. Again, a CPC article. All those in, is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
3-0. Then there's a Riverside Cemetery, again, a CPC article.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Again, these are to include. All those in favor?
Aye.
Zero. And then we've got the appropriations for 017, which is the perpetual.
Motion for R.
Yeah, second. It's our annual housekeeping.
Yeah, exactly. R. We have a motion made and seconded. Again, this is to include for the CPC fund for the upcoming year. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0, please.
Can't do S yet, right?
There's no value yet for R.
S.
S. And then T, we'll get clarification on before we move, just to make sure it's right. And then consent articles.
Motion to consent article.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded to include the consent articles. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, 3-0, please, Sherry. All right, so part of that's complete, and again, we have a little bit of homework to do, but that makes the warrant a living document. We've got it included, and we can move forward.
May as well take care of the ones we can.
Okay. Thank you, everybody. So on the budget, we have, and thank you for the font and the size of the print, and including in our binders, by the way.
Kind of big, don't you think?
I kind of like it, actually. I want to go back to the number two font and go, wow.
Where's my magnifying glass?
So what I'd like tonight is the board to take a look in particular at the revenue sheet. We have our expense budgets complete. There aren't too many moving parts left in the expense request. We'll review those at a future meeting. But at this point, it looks like total annual budget increase with all of the moving pieces. Now remember, we have hundreds of lines in the budget. With all of the moving pieces, though, Sherry's come and said, looks like about 2% increase in total. It's focused in a couple of areas, but there are savings in the debt restructuring, there are a debt buyout, debt complete. Our total...
2% even, look at that.
Yeah. Our total general government... Again, that line looks like 2.9%. And then our total protection, which is fire, police, town inspections, 1.6%. A lot of that has to do with the juggling of the SEMS coming off of last year and going into an assessment format. That's important to bear in mind. Our other categories, highway, health, sanitation, library, schools, retirement benefits, miscellaneous, and reserve, they add 3% in total. And then we have the areas of expense that are actually covered by direct revenues, wastewater treatment plant. And it's really important to bear in mind. We'll see that on the revenue side. They are coming in here at a total of, they don't actually have their own total, minus $67,000 primarily through debt, with a total budget increase of $141,106 at this point, or 2%. Now, Sherry, this is your first budget in Sunderland. Has this been the easiest thing you've done?
It's been pretty good. But I don't know if that's the easy. No,
Never that simple, are they?
Budgeting is never easy.
It's never easy. Are there any highlights or risks that we should be aware of at this point?
No, just a couple of areas that are worth taking another look at. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we're getting to the budget scrubbing side of the fence right now. Okay, comments to the board as what's presented. We've had our budget hearings jointly with the Finance Committee and department heads, as well as with the schools. Any comments, Tom or David?
Yeah, seeing a 10.2% increase for the elementary schools, it's difficult. Yes. I understand it, but it's a difficult number.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess I'm not asking for, at some point we have to start looking, I would think we have to start looking at administrative costs.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it seems like we always look at teachers, but at some point, I think we have to look at administrative costs, which seems to be and find if they're in line.
Yep.
And we really, you know, we really haven't looked at that in a number of years, so at some point that has to be, I think that has to be looked at.
Been an ongoing topic of discussion now, yeah.
Well, it I think it needs to be.
Yep, it should be.
I'm concerned. Our assessment for Frontier, while it, there's a lot of reasons why it went down. One of the reasons is that the school committee voted to apply one-time money to it, a large chunk of money, $250,000. We have to remember that if next year that, and the school has done that before. They, it was very common to have money out of the E&D account applied against the budget. Two, 3 years ago, that went away. It went to 150, 170, whatever it was. It went to nothing. Then we were scrambling to meet that budget. So this year is $250,000, which I hear is one-time cost. So I still think that we need to address that with the school committee and say, okay, we understand you have one-time costs, $250,000. What's your starting point next year?
Right. Mm-hmm. That is a really good point.
Because if that $250,000 doesn't go back in, then
it'll come from somewhere.
So you can have a 0% increase, and we could still have a significant increase in our assessment next year.
While not using that level of E&D for other one times.
Right.
Yeah, I agree.
Right. Or capital. Yeah, I know that they came to us with a list of capital stuff, and then that got pulled back. And at some point, we know those things are going to have to be addressed. So.
Good point. So Tom, to extend that conversation to the other district that we participate in, it took a number of years before the application of E&D at the Franklin Tech was weaned down to a sustainable model.
They were doing what, $400,000 a year?
$400,000, right.
Yeah.
Right, exactly.
Wow.
You look at those numbers and go, whoa, like, wait a minute, that's a real charge of money.
Yep.
But it took a number of years, and their business team up there had understood the concerns of the town for those years and pulled that back.
And see, myself, I understand that our assessment to South County EMS is mm-hmm. going to go down. Mm-hmm. That's because South County Board of Oversight voted to use $144,000
right.
Out of our, what they call retained earnings, to help offset the cost. And again, that's fine. It appears, if you look at projections for next year, with the way that the money is coming in from the ambulance calls, that number will be sustainable again for next year. So we should be able to get back to coming to a better definitive numbers for putting South County EMS. But that being said, I would say there's a bunch of one-time mm-hmm. reductions in here that are allowing the budget to stay. You look at the debt and interest. I mean, we're saving $67,000 on debt and interest.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we happen to have the timing of the buyout of several pieces from the prior year.
So, I mean, that's, I mean, taking $67,000 of debt and interest off, that's a sizable chunk of money. So, and again, and a lot of people, the only thing they want to know is how their taxes are going to be affected. I will just say one thing. It's like, it's more important than just how your taxes, it's how your taxes are and yeah. how the budgets are created. Mm-hmm. I'm that an elementary 10.2% is a concern. And I understand why it is there. I'm just saying it's a concern because you can't do that 2 years in a row.
There is a good point. You know, we look at these budgets, and you guys have heard me say this before, kind of like single frames in a movie. If you put 10 budgets together, one of the reasons we have budget numbers in our sheets from 2009 to date is because it's the movie, right? Mm-hmm. People look at the trend.
Right.
And you're absolutely right, Tom, with respect to those kinds of increases. There is a strategic view that comes out of these exercises. And it has been a bit of a mantra, certainly for this board, about what is sustainable, what services can we provide based on our available revenue streams. and that is just not going to go away. And 10% for anybody for 2 years in a row, in particular a department that has such a large impact on our resources, is not sustainable.
So to me, that's a concern. Mm-hmm. Frontier budget, although our assessment's going down, mm-hmm. I understand how it's getting there.
Yeah.
And at $250,000, and I understand it's nice not having to pay it this year.
Mm-hmm.
But we've always looked at not just this coming year, but the next year coming.
Right.
And I didn't hear anybody guarantee from the Frontier School Committee that there's going to put that $250,000 back next year. And or, and I would say, whatever, somehow I'm going to write a letter and send it to Frontier, ask it to be sent to Frontier, mm-hmm. about what next year budget number is compared to.
Right? Hmm. Because there are a series of one-times that go across the years. And we've seen one-times, whether they be buyouts for retiring faculty and staff, or they be one-time purchases, and does that constitute the zero for the upcoming year?
Right.
And that becomes the real...
You keep shifting your baseline.
Exactly. That becomes the real rub.
Well, the shift is going... right. So, and so... Mm-hmm. So In a very simple way to say it is that the adding of $250,000 from E&D was to, I believe, Scott, you were there, mm-hmm. was to cover many one-time expenses.
Correct.
So next year, does the budget total start at $1,250,000,
right.
or does it start at $1 million?
Right.
Now I would argue that it should start at $1 million. Because those $250,000 in this year budget were one-time expenses.
Right, so you shouldn't see them recurring, or they shouldn't have a long-term effect, in theory.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Typically, what happens, though, is that the budget starts at $1,250,000, but you don't have the revenue to support that $1,250,000. So that's a concern. And again, I see it as a pitfall going, not this cycle will cover. Next FY18 budget,
yep. 18-19.
I can already see trouble,
yep.
brewing because of those numbers,
really,
and that scares me. And it's not just about schools, mm-hmm. but what we have for South County EMS, mm-hmm. we have that also. You know, the 144,000. That's one-time money, basically. Mm-hmm. Those are concerns.
And that's a red flag to have in every given budget cycle.
That was one of the things that started us looking at administrative things, too,
right.
because we need to look at everything. And, you know, if push comes to shove, if you need to cut something mm-hmm. somewhere,
mm-hmm.
you know, obviously you prefer to keep staff on if you can. You know.
Good
but
point.
You know, I had the good fortune to speak with Steve Cool Saturday, and I asked him about the budget, and they're working on the budget. He says their budget should be coming out in two and a half weeks. And he said it's probably going to be a little bit, you know, it'll probably be a little bit different. It always is.
Yeah, right.
Not that he has any secret.
Mm-hmm.
But then they can come out with a budget, but then it goes into that conference committee where everybody sits down and...
Yep.
So they're and like Steve says, there's a lot of pressure from a lot of different areas that have been down for a long period of time. So,
and you know, that's a larger view of the pressures we've seen. Well, certainly since this board's been in place, but in particular post 2009, where those pressures are to restore the sense of loss. You know, where are the actual growth pressures? And then it's fascinating as you go about this budgeting process. There are growth pressures. There are, you know, legitimate growth pressures. Then there are some that are legacy costs. There are some that are initiatives that you're trying to have moving forward. There are some that are just, you know, chugging along at a percentage year after year after year. You get past a decade and you go, oh, well, wait a minute. Blank percentage after a number of years equals a big charge and a big impact. So, good points. Good points all the way.
We've got that increase at the elementary school, but we really haven't
it's one of those things where your cost increases, you really don't see anything for the increased cost. It's not like we're adding a program or a teacher or something like that, you know? So.
Like a town vehicle for the town administrator or anything like that.
Exactly.
No, she just wants a Shelby Cobra, too.
I was surprised, you know, couldn't afford the convertible. That was the issue.
But, and again, it's, and again, you...
You
understand why the certain areas went up, but you can't think that that's normal,
right?
And you can't accept it.
Right. And you took this budget in a folder and saving it for next year,
well,
so
exactly
I have it
right
to reference.
Yeah, right.
I will say that the greatest thing I ever learned in history classes, either in high school or college, was that history has a propensity to repeat itself. And we've been there with our budgeting problems, and people watching this may or may not realize, but every time we've had a downturn, we could predict that it was coming 2 years in advance.
Right.
You could predict 2 years in advance when there was going to be a problem with a budget.
Because mm-hmm. there are certain antecedents that were just mm-hmm. feeding yeah. it. They're triggers, antecedents or triggers, leading indicators. And it was like, oh,
great.
Well, you see them.
These lines can't line up.
Right.
Right.
So you see them.
Yeah.
You know they're coming.
Yeah.
And that's the hardest part about sitting up here is because 90% of the people in our town don't see those triggers mm-hmm. like we see them, mm-hmm. and you try to put out the red flag, but it's like the third base coach that has, you know, Jacoby Ellsbury running around third base. He ain't stopping for my stop signal. He's going to try to get home, and you try to stop him, but they're not going to stop. And the more you put the brake signals up, the faster they're running. So, I don't know. I just hope people understand. I said, this year is going to be an easy budget for us to make, relatively speaking. Mm-hmm. But I see problems 2-3 years down the road.
Right. Good points.
Well, that's it. People look at it and they think, oh, it's an easy one, and then they kind of forget.
Right.
And they just, you know, nothing to worry about really right now. And
I can't tell you how many times I've been in proposals. Presenting a proposal, and the applicant goes like this.
Okay, next.
Yeah.
And that's it. You just looked at 200 lines and went 2%. Oh, it must be
that
great.
That one number in the
right?
bottom.
That's
there.
Not. Yep. It's not the one thing that's important.
Yep. It's not over that 2.5%, so it just kind of disappears.
If you could flip to the revenue page, I think there's a couple of important pieces on the revenue page to bear in mind. Sure, this is use of free cash inside of the framework of the free cash guidelines.
Correct.
Okay. And then we are using, for the first time in a handful of years now, a little bit of assessor's overlay funds. First of all, there actually are some assessor's overlay
funds. I was
going to
say, yeah.
It's important to bear in mind the assessors, when the rate is set, there is by statute a requirement to raise a value in anticipation of abatements. And when that value gets higher and higher and higher, the board can request, and I forget how many years it is, but anybody try to keep a couple of years in reserves, overlay surplus. And that is being used this year. You go down the list, and to me, the area of primary concern is not the top part, which is tax levy, cherry sheet, local receipts, other availables. That's pretty straightforward. Mm-hmm. It's that the out-of-budget expenditures, in particular the assessments and offsets, aren't quite ironed out yet. Mm. So this number down here of, you know, being able to be inside of the 2.5 and have some available levy capacity remaining is still a bit of an unknown until we get out of that conference Tom was talking about
right.
earlier. That's a big deal. So those red numbers, they're all big too. They're all in the 6 digits except for, you know, the last two. Anyway, so it looks at this point, with available revenues and requested expenses before this next round of budget scrubbing, we are structured to use free cash inside of the guidelines, put a little bit more money in the OPEB trust fund, fund capital stabilization, which we're going to talk about here in just a minute, and then hopefully be prepared and have a little bit of opportunity in the event that the offsets, cherry sheet offsets, state assessments, allowances for abatements actually is going to be fixed, and then other amounts is fixed, so that the more than half a million dollars that is coming as a wild card on the expense side, we have some opportunity to work inside of.
It's always a waiting game.
In this case here, for that last section, you're absolutely right, David. It is a waiting game. Okay, next up, if there's no more discussion about the omnibus budget, this is the time of year where we add capital stabilization. Was passed 3 years ago. This will be their second full year of appropriating on the levy, adding to the levy the monies for capital stabilization. Town meeting and a ballot question passed $100,000 in that statute, adopting the statute and then adopting the value. The value is allowed to go up by 2.5% per year, and the recommendation in front of us is to assess $105,063 to be appropriated to the capital stabilization fund. That said, it's important to bear in mind it's still all town meetings appropriation. You guys, everybody who goes to town meetings still gets a clean view of the capital plan and the capital budget and appropriates from this. The board's goal tonight, or the board's vote tonight, only allows it to be raised. Another discussion? If there's no other discussion, is there a motion to assess the additional levy for capital stabilization of $105,063?
Motion.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. 3-0. I want to make sure I captured that correctly, too. That's an important piece of teaching. Okay.
I won't make any dumb clean jokes. We can't talk about levy.
Is it dry already?
That's levy it is.
Tom, you had mentioned earlier there's a public information session here.
Wednesday
on the 30th. Wait, yeah. And we have a posting downstairs for that, and I'm sure it'll be on the website as well. And again, that's SCEMS and the BOO directors. There's an agenda right here, 7 o'clock, Whitney Town Office Building. Okay. How are we doing the calendar, Sherry?
We are doing good.
So the warrant in, the warrant's closed. We have moved to include a few things, and we're headed into April.
Whew. On a roll.
It just time flies. Okay. Any other comments of the board? If not, our next meeting is going to be here on the 4th. And on the 9th, it's the last day to register to vote. It's really important to bear in mind. Town meeting and the annual election in May is what we're talking about here with this registration. Stop in and see the town clerk down here, the town offices. April 9th is the end of the registration. That's the last day. That's, again, by statute. 29th is is the annual town meeting. And then May 7th, the subsequent Saturday, is the town election. Okay. Any other discussion? If not, is there a motion to adjourn?
Oh, motion, I guess.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. 3.75?
Aye, aye.
Tom, you in on that aye?
All set.
All right. Thank you, Marina.